returned there from space in May of 2011, right?
Yes.
Having in mind that the astronauts of every expedition spent 6 months aboard the ISS, how do you manage your clothing, eating, drinking? I suppose you don't do any laundry up there, nor cooking, right?
Well, the microgravity environment forces us to do things in different ways that we do it on here on the ground. And certain things that are easy here, they're almost impossible, and the opposite. So, for example, we don't do laundry. It's not possible. Or at least, let's say that we don't have a way to do it now. It would be nice actually to do it. So we just actually do use clothes and then throw it away. But we don't change as often as here on the ground. I mean, I was amazed when they gave me my pants, and they gave me 3 pairs of pants for 6 months. I'm like, what? And then they gave me my shirts, and they're like, well, no, shirts we give you a little bit more, let's say 4. I'm like, what? I mean, so it's kind of, but it actually works pretty well, and there are no problems. We do recycle a lot. I mean, station is one of the places where recycling is to the limit. We do recycle water, urine is recycled, sweat is recycled. We collect the sweat and recycle it again. Food and clothing and experiments and everything come up on the station every month, more or less, with a resupply vehicle from the ground. It's a complex operation because it's like if you would have a truck coming to your house, attaching to your front door, and then you open, and then you are inside the truck, and you have to take everything out. And from the on the station on the space, everything floats. So you have to really put them away. You cannot just put it there on the floor. You have to put it away, and then you don't find them anymore. So you have to really make sure that you find things and other stuff. So handling all of this is complicated and challenging. But this is also one of the reasons why we do these things, because it's challenging. And when we do challenging things, then is the time when we learn things. If you always do the same and always do something that is comfortable to us, then we don't learn. Mm-hmm. So this is also another reasons to do this complicated things.
How do you sleep in space? Is it different from sleeping here?
Well, it is different because there is no gravity here. You know, we are used to go to bed and we lay on bed and we have our own position, which is linked to gravity. Now you go in space, you're not, and you don't feel anymore the bed, so it's kind of difficult. Everyone has different approaches, and everyone feels it in a different way. For what concerns me, I had no problems. I slept really, really well in space. You know, you don't have any more neck pain or something because there is no more gravity there. So I try to take advantage of this situation instead of making it bad for me. And dreams, you dream the same, and I mean, again, it's very subjective, but I thought it was actually very enjoyable, even sleeping there, on waking up in the morning and not knowing where you are, upside down, not upside down. I mean, it's very strange, mm-hmm. and actually strange, but in an enjoyable way.
Mm-hmm. How do you keep track of time on board ISS?
We do not... obviously, because we are going around Earth so fast, and every half an hour there is a sunset or sunrise, so you don't really look outside the window to know if it is day or night. You get really confused if you do that. But so we do set our watch on GMT, Universal Time, London Time, essentially. And then we track time using that. And our day is arranged on a 24-hour scale. And we do more or less the way we work. We do here on the ground. We do work from usually 7:30 in the morning until 7:30 in the evening. There's a little bit of a break for lunch. And then, you know, you clean yourself, eat, do some things, and then you go to bed and wake up next day.
Mm-hmm. Can you share with us some of your highlights during your staying on ISS?
Highlights? I think the first highlight is that You will get up there. That's already the first one. And then you find yourself in this weird place where gravity does not exist anymore. And then if you look out of the window, you have a view that is out of this world. These are the kind of highlights. It takes about a month and a half to actually learn to work in this environment, because microgravity is very disconcerting. And then you can do a lot of things. I mean, you're now running, you're in charge of the environment, you do a lot of nice things. It was really nice when I was able to do experiments the way they were supposed to, without making errors, getting the results. When we were, you know, talking to schools, we ended up talking, for me it was important, talking to the Italian president, but we talked to Obama, we talked to Putin, I talked to some very important people in Italy. We had a video conference with the Pope. I mean, we had a lot of things that were really interesting and make us feel, you know, kind of special. Makes us feel we were outside of this world, but a lot of people were really looking at us and were really things. But even normal people, I mean, every time we talk to 77 schools from up there, 10,000 students, I mean, and every time I would talk to a school, I would feel like special. I mean, I would feel different, and those were always highlights. It was interesting. It was a continuous highlight, and of course, then you come back to Earth, and this also is something that is a highlight. Riding the Soyuz back on Earth is it's quite an impressive ride.
Mm-hmm. You took a whole bunch of pictures in space, and I must say that they're all incredible. Do you have any favorites?
Well. I started having favorites. I started with, you know, liking certain things. I actually thought, wow, I'm going to take two or three pictures of places on Earth that I really want to go and visit when I come back. And then, you know, I started piling them up, and by the end of the mission, I have like 300 places where I want to go. So it's almost impossible. I don't have enough time in my life unless I stop doing what I'm doing and doing all of that. But it was amazing when I wanted to look at something special, like the pyramids or the wall of China or something, and it takes quite a challenge to get them, and I was able to see them. So those pictures are special.
Did the social media, Twitter, Facebook, or Flickr change the way you communicate with people while you're in space?
Well, the social Twitter gave me a very Twitter or Flickr gave me a very unique perspective on being up in space. I mean, being able to communicate in this way was new to me, and it was really nice because it allowed me to share things that I was doing up there that I was enjoying, and finding that a lot of people would enjoy the same things. It really helped me in feeling not alone up there. I really saw the Twitter stream, and it was really amazing to see what people were saying about this thing. So I think it's a very good way to communicate, it's a very good way to share experiences, and it's a very good way, if you are in space, to make people feel they are up there. It's not, unfortunately, it's still a place where people cannot really go easily, but this was a way to connect, and I think they were very effective.
On March 11th, while Japan was struck by the massive quake and tsunami, you were on board the ISS. How did you experience this biblical catastrophe?
Well, a lot of things happened while we were up there in space. And it's, you know, you feel like you are in a... You feel the Earth, and you feel that the Earth is a living thing, and you feel that people up there are kind of suffering on in a strange situation. We felt sorry because even the control center closed down, the Japanese control center. We understood something serious happened because the Japanese are very meticulous, and that morning they were not at our standard Monday morning briefing. Wow. This is impressive. Something huge must happen. So we actually got some information. Then we really tried hard to take pictures, and from up there we could see the flooding. We could see some of the destructions. It's difficult to see from space, but we could see something was different. And we felt close to Japan. Control center came back online very quick, but it was obvious that something really major happened there, and you know, we tried to be as supportive as we could.
Mm-hmm. There is a big debate about the huge amount of money that goes to space exploration, if they are well spent, and if we should stop space flight and focus more on the problems we have on planet Earth. What's your opinion? Do we benefit from space exploration?
Well, I think these are valid concerns, because obviously in going in space we have to use resources that are significant. On the other hand, you know, this perception that we take money and send it to space, it's wrong. I've been on the space station for a long time. I never see any money in space. I mean, we build things on the ground and we send them in space. The money stays on Earth. The money makes engineers work, make our schools work, our industry work, challenge them. So I feel that it's used effectively here on Earth to make people work. We can discuss if we could use it for other purposes, and of course everybody has his own opinion. I think that technology is very important. Through technologies we are able to live better, live more efficiently, and I think a society that keep research as one of their primary goals are the one that go farther. So I think the money spent in space or for space activities, it's well worth. Yes, we need to do things attentively because money is a scarce resource and we need to be attentive. And so also space needs to have checks, and sometimes there are excesses. Sometimes we choose strategic goals that are kind of not exactly perfect, but this is a process, and in the process things like this happen. We just need to be attentive, and for I really believe that the money that we use to spend on this activity is a very well worth money.
One last question. While you were up there and you were looking down to our beautiful planet, our fragile oasis, as Ron Garan said, was the need or the feeling to believe in a higher power has grown? For example, did you feel closer to God or to human?
Well, that's a very deep question, and you know, I'm an engineer. I usually do things practical, so this kind of theological question are kind of difficult for me. But yes, from up there you see the Earth, and I really felt it was like a ship in space. Difficult to think that, you know, it just appeared like that. At the same time, you can see how, you know, we were kind of lucky to be in a certain situations, distance from the sun and all these sort of things like that. Yes, it feels this is not casual. It feels that this is a very delicate balance that we are living in. The Earth is a delicate balance, and we really think that we need to understand more, take care of it, and expand our knowledge.
As an American aerospace engineer and senior NASA manager said, Jesko put a camera, he said that the most important product from space is not Teflon or pharmaceuticals, but peace.
Well, this is I think, yes, this is correct. I mean, technology, it's very important, but one of the goals of the things that happen in space is it shows us that we can work together, and we can focus our efforts in building something that is not against each other, or not to have a supremacy from a military point of view on each other, but in acquire more knowledge. And by acquiring more knowledge together, of course we can think of peaceful things to do, to work all together. And space station and going in space can also be seen or in one way, in this way. Mm-hmm.
We could continue talking for hours. It was an honor, and thank you for your time talking with us here on Flash Radio. Do you have any special message to send to the listeners of Flash Radio?
Well, I would mention the things that I always mention, so specifically to school kids, and I tell them that, you know, we need to have dreams, and we need to believe on these dreams, because if we work hard enough, dreams, even the impossible one, once in a while, become reality. This is a message that I think is valid for everybody, even for me. I mean, I'm trying to figure out now what to do when I grow up after the mission. What is my next dream? So I would tell people to dream, keep dreaming. I would tell them also though to wake up, because dreaming you are sleeping. Then wake up once in a while and make these dreams happen. And this is a power that we do have. We just have to have the strength to actually understand it and to make this dream come true. And this is possible. Mm-hmm.
Thank you very much, Harry. It was a true honor.
Thank you.